when I was young. Who knew my heart? He knew my sorrow. He held my hand and he led me to trust him.
What's up, guys? Go ahead and share the video. We'll be going live on there in just a minute after this song. Feel free to worship with us.
Now I am here in the safety of your love. I trust your heart and your intentions. Trust you completely. I'm listening intently.
What's up, Edo?
You got me through.
And
as I change, may I love you more.
Praise the Lord. We're just talking about your beard, man. You become like a Mr. Logan's junior brother there. You got claws in your arms.
I wanna see. trust you completely.
Yes, Lord.
I'm listening intently. You'll guide me through these many shadows.
Yes, you will.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles.
What's up, guys? Coming up right now is The Way, where we dig in, dissect, and share the word. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So let's knock the dust off the Bibles, crack them open, and get in the word.
There's a better life.
What's going on, everybody?
Hey, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, man. 2020.
Yes. Amen. Well, man.
Man. Oh, man. What's in store?
Man, a lot.
God is in store, I think.
God's on the move. Well, thank you, everybody, for joining us tonight. And every Wednesday here at 7 o'clock, we've been gone for the last 2 weeks because of Christmas and New Year's. We're super excited to be back. And listen, we want to give a shout-out to our sponsors, Marco Electric, for all your electrical needs. And if you are a qualified electrician seeking employment, you can contact them at...
You can call at 706-955-9836. You can also email us a resume, any information, to markcoelectrical@gmail.com.
Amen. And guys, if you guys want to partner up with us, or if you'd like us to give a shout out on the radio, you guys send us a message on the Way page on Facebook, The Way 99.9, and we'll give you some more information about it. And man, I'm just super excited to be back. I've missed everybody. I've missed being on here.
Yeah,
it's like brand new all over again.
I know it. Yeah. It's a new, all okay. Things made new.
And let me throw this out there. I want to start doing this a little bit more, but if you have any electrical need in the industrial world, you can give us a call and we would gladly come and try to work with you in any way we could. Amen. Again, it's Markco Electrical, 706-955-9836 for your industrial power and control networking needs. Give us a call.
I pinned that email address to the page, so it's going to sit there.
Is it M-A-R-C?
Yeah,
M-A-R-K-C-O.
Oh, I jacked it up. M-A-R-K-C-O. Electrical, right?
Yeah. Well, guys, everybody out there listening on the air, thank you guys for tuning in. Everybody on Facebook, thanks for joining us tonight, man. I'm super excited. It's going to be a good program. I know it. So, hey, Miss Julie, how you doing?
I'm doing good. You guys have a good Christmas?
We did. We did have a good Christmas. It was, with the kids, the blended family, you know, everybody, they got to go in like 10 different directions.
Wow.
You know, it's cool, though. Yeah, we just try to just do what you can, and then the kids want to take off, and so Crystal and I actually wound up getting to spend a lot of time together, which was good for us.
Amen.
So we really enjoyed it, you know.
How does Crystal like your beard?
She doesn't.
Or she doesn't.
Listen, I was just talking. I was actually ran into John Kenny from the Quest at Starbucks. We saw him.
Yeah.
And he said something about it, and I said, "Well, that's why I have to keep this. I can't let the top get too long." She didn't like it too well, and I'm still, I wouldn't be surprised if I woke up one morning and it was gone.
Go, Crystal.
Hey, just do it. Just do it. If you wake up, though, and your eyes are still in there, we're good.
That's right. Yeah.
You won't be a Samson case, so that would be all right.
Amen. I told her it was like No Shave November or something like that. I just kept it going. So we'll see what happens.
You gonna get the real long one?
Yeah, like the Duck Dynasty, you know.
Wow. that's something.
Yeah. So
let's do a shout out of some of the dear friends and ministry that we have affiliations with.
She said, "I'm starting to like it a little."
Crystal said, "I'm starting to like it a little." Yeah. How good is it's growing on her, but like it's growing on me.
Yeah,
a little at a time. Well, shout out to the ministries.
Yeah, we got New Beginnings in Christ in Garfield, Georgia, and really feel like we're to open tonight up in prayer as we go into the new year.
Absolutely.
Let's declare the word of the Lord in prayer. By prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be known unto God.
Guys, and listen, I want to go ahead and put the phone number out there too. The phone number here, guys, listen, we want you to call in here. We want to hear from you. We want to we want you to call in with prayers. We want to pray with you. We want to talk to you. The number here is 803-335-3131. Again, the studio phone number is 803-335-3131. I took Crystal down to New Beginnings for the first time. She got to go down there and meet Donald and Joanne, guys. And that's you know, we got blessed down there. It was just an amazing place. 94 guys down there in that place getting set free.
Amen.
It's a good place. We also got Grace Place Farms. And if you guys, anybody that didn't make it out last night, missed a good
awesome
service with Pastor Daniel Zelli from Brisbane, Australia, Glory City, Brisbane. And but that's every Tuesday night, guys. Every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. Come hungry for the word and for food. And that's 1422 Reynolds Farm Road in Grovetown,
Georgia. That was an awesome message. I really loved his humility. Transparency and humility, and it was just awesome. And it was just a very revealing message. Well, a great revelation.
Todd and I were talking about it on the way home. You know, it's just that, you know, the simplicity of it. You know, it's so simple, because I complicate the hell into things, you know, personally. I will. If I start getting to thinking and start, you know, I'll complicate the hell into something, and it's just so simple, you know. But put God before Facebook, you know.
Or YouTube.
You know, for YouTube.
Catching the morning news.
Brianna said hello. Brianna Blackenberger. Who's that? That's your...
Yes,
that's your something.
Yes,
because the last name match. She did. She's all spelled right.
Brianna, Josh.
Oh, come on.
I had the pleasure of officiating, marrying them.
That's
East Tennessee. It was a beautiful wedding.
Oh, that was a few months ago, wasn't it? That was.
It's been a while.
Been a while.
Okay. Yeah, that a few months ago was my. Other nephew, Hunter. Yes, Hunter and Ashley.
Okay. Well, congratulations, Brianna.
You know, that lesson that we learned yesterday was, to me, it was, you know, a lot of times if the word of God come to you with instruction, you push it away. Because you'd be like, well, I already know that. Or, nah, that's not. You know, pride kills you from accepting the word of God. Like the word of God that came to you for instruction. And you know, it is only who the Lord loves that he will instruct. You know, like if God, when you start stopping, when you no longer get instruction from the Holy Spirit on what to do, whether good or bad, especially bad, like they your case is, they're done with you. The Godhead don't care about you no more. Because you know it, and you don't want to listen. Because all they're doing is they're trying to guide you. He said when the Spirit of Truth comes, he will guide you. So when the Spirit of Truth starts speaking to all of us, regardless of titles and whatever we carry, the natural response is to say, yes, Lord, I will obey. That's what really... To me, like when he was sharing, that's what really was like, hey, Johanna, if the Lord is guiding you, are you obeying? Are you obeying 50-50, 60-40, 80-20, 90-10, 100-100? What are you doing? You know? I was checking on those things. Because if the Lord stops instructing you, it's just a bad deal. That's a bad deal for you.
Yeah.
You know? So, you know... And the word of the Lord of instruction can come from whoever. You see, what you should be wondering, should be worried about is the word of the Lord. Not is this guy who I would like to hear it from.
Mm-hmm.
You see, that also throws people off.
Mm-hmm.
It sometimes just over familiarity, you know. I'm too cool with this guy. He can't tell me nothing. You know, like, nah, I don't think he's a, you know, nah.
Yeah.
Or it's like, no.
It's like this. It's like when I could say the same thing to, I'll just use my wife as an example.
Okay.
And I could say the same thing to Crystal, say the exact same thing, but then she hear it from Mark.
Yeah.
And she's gonna, oh,
yeah.
I mean, because it's happened,
right?
And I'm like, and I'll be like, you know, but at least she got it, you know,
right.
You know, and in the same way with me, she'd probably say the same thing to me, you know, and you know, and then I'd hear it from Mark, and I might receive it,
yeah.
So,
well, Jesus, people didn't pay attention to him in his own homeland either, a lot of regards. Some did.
Yeah,
you know, he said a prophet has no honor in his own country.
That's wow. Right. Yep.
And
yeah. Oh, that's the.
That's right.
So.
Yep. Oh Lord.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So wow. You know.
Yeah.
You can't take that too personal.
Mm. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
When it happens, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
God was standing in front of them,
yeah,
and they didn't realize it. Even wow. After he did things that only God could do.
Yeah. Wow.
And he still didn't get it.
It didn't matter. So, nah.
And God does things in our lives, and we still don't get it at times. Yeah. I know. I'm. You know.
Yeah.
But Yohani really hit on something that, about wisdom.
Yeah.
You know, as far as instruction, the Bible would say that a wise man receives instruction or wisdom and gets wiser.
Mm-hmm.
I really feel led as we're going to go into the spirit of prayer, hopefully, and just interweave everything in tonight. Let's start out. Let's just read a little bit. It's called Security and Wisdom. And if there's anything for such a time as this that we need in our lives, each one of us, every human being is wisdom, understanding, knowledge. The Bible would tell us to value and give honor to that higher than silver or gold. And I really think for at least the first part of this year, we really need to dedicate a certain amount of time in the 1 hour that we have to reading a certain amount of Proverbs.
Okay.
Seriously.
Yeah.
Because it's, we need wisdom.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Well, let's turn over. Why would we need wisdom? Well, you can't give anything you don't have.
Right.
Let's turn real quickly, Michael. Turn over to Luke chapter 1, verse 17. And one of the mandates that we have as sons and daughters of God is to live a wise life. And Michael's going to read that. And going back to the little saying or cliche, you can't give something you don't have. I want you to look at the mandate, what our role is, like John the Baptist. We have the same role.
Yeah.
As John the Baptist was the forerunner to the first coming of Christ, we're the forerunner to the second coming of Christ.
That's right.
We're the one that goes before.
That's right.
Okay, and what we do will determine whether or not people know Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And this is a mandate right here.
That's right.
And would you share that? I think it's 17 and 18. It might be 16, 17, but you got it.
Well, it's just Luke chapter 1, and we'll start at 16. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God, and he shall go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord.
There you go. And you know, as he was to be that light to the house of Israel. Mm-hmm. We're to be that light wherever we're at.
That's right. That's right.
So that mandate is a mandate on our lives, along with Isaiah 61 is also a mandate mm-hmm. upon a believer. Turn over, Michael, or somebody turn over to Acts chapter 26. Let's look at verse 18. See, Paul received a mandate. Mm-hmm. The Lord had a purpose for Paul's life, and we know that Paul ended up authoring and through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, authoring a lot of the New Testament.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesus had a plan for Paul's life.
In Acts 26:18, it says, and these words are in red, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me.
See how that works with Luke chapter 1, mm-hmm. verse 16 and 17. It's all about the ones that we will come in contact with, mm-hmm. the ones that we will influence. And the fact of it is, I'm either influencing positively in a Christ-like manner in love mm-hmm. or negatively.
Yeah.
Negatively.
I'm influencing one way or the other.
Yeah, it's one way or the other.
Yeah.
And you see how both of them, that was a mandate upon Paul's life. God had a plan. The Lord Jesus had a plan for Paul's life. We're the same plan for our life.
That's right.
That we're the what? Salt and light.
Yep.
Of the world. Amen. So, and going back to Luke chapter 1, that we would turn the heathen to the wisdom of the just, right? Mm-hmm. Verse 17, I think.
Yeah.
Luke chapter 1. I must be wise. I can't give something I don't have.
That's right.
And we must have wisdom, the spirit of wisdom. Mm-hmm. And if we go back now to Proverbs chapter 4, we'll read the instructions of a father, a mother to a son.
Yeah.
And
you want to read the whole thing?
Let's see.
Starting at verse 1.
Oh, definitely. I think starting in verse 1. And there's a lot of good.
Probably 1 through 9 here.
Yeah, there's a lot of good nuggets right there. Well, as we start, let's go over to verse in chapter 4, but let's start in guidance for the young. As we start out this new year, and we're going to implement wisdom into this. Because let me tell you something, wisdom is required every day.
Amen.
We're faced with decisions every day. And the Bible would say to call out, cry out for understanding, to cry out for knowledge, So let's start in Proverbs 3, and I'll just read it down through verse 6 real quickly, and then somebody pick up in chapter 4 or anywhere else in chapter 3. I'll take it down through verse 8. My son, do not forget my law, and this is the guidance for the young. And let me implement this and see if you guys agree. There has never been a time like we're faced with today that there is so much coming at the young.
Yeah.
Now I want you to think about it. It's a lot different. You can, when I was young, let's just talk about, we call them girly magazines. Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, you might be running around at your buddies or something like this, or just everyday life. And every once in a while you might see a Playboy.
Yeah.
I mean, just being real. But today you can even get on your phone and something pop up before you know it.
That's right.
In other words, just so much is just bombarding the people of today. Every one of us, there is so much bombarding. And we're at a time in our nation that no one knows exactly what the truth is.
That's right.
Seriously. Seriously. Everybody's wondering if you hear this on this news station. You hear this on this news station. You hear this on this news station. Everybody, I wish I knew who was telling the truth.
Yeah. Yep.
Because you can't, the social media, the news and all, you know, you can't do it. And, yeah. And we've got to be able to discern.
Yeah.
We've got to be able to discern. All right. Guidance for the young. Proverbs 3:1. My son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands, for the length of days and long life and peace they will add to you. That's good news right there.
Amen.
Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet or the table of your heart, and so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man. And verse 5 would say, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge him. Who are we talking about right here? We're talking about the person of Jesus Christ, the living word of God. Mm-hmm. Okay. In verse 6, it says, in all of your ways, acknowledge him, the word of God. Mm-hmm. And he shall direct your path. And not only does it say path, it says it's plural there, right? Paths. Right. Is it right. Plural paths. In your all's Bible? Because let me tell you something, in life there's many directions.
That's right.
Amen.
Yep.
So then he goes on in verse 7, do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil, and it will be health to your flesh and strength to your bones. Verse 9, honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all of your increase. Verse 10, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. You know, God wants to bless you. He wants your barns to be filled. He wants your vats to be overflowing.
That's right.
He desires that you would prosper.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Does anybody see any other verses there in chapter 3?
You know, I've been digging in on the word sustain lately. You know, and just going back through it on how to sustain. And this is, you know, how to live this life, how to live this normal Christian life. And this is just, you know, this guidance, this wisdom in the word of God, you know, but then, you know, when he's talking about directing your paths, I just keep thinking about the fact that, you know, you have to keep your eyes focused on Jesus no matter what, you know. I mean, we can know the right things to do, and there's a lot. We can know good things to do, and there's a lot of good things to do. But sometimes a good thing, even though it's a good thing, it's still going to take me off track of where God wants me to go. Mm. You know, I mean, sometimes I can get choked out by the cares of the world by good things, too, by going to too many places, doing too many things. And right. It's anything that's taking my focus off of Jesus, because He can't direct my path if I ain't listening. If I'm not spending time, that intimate time with him, I'm not listening to him.
Or position yourself.
And then I can't, if I'm not, you know, then he can't direct me, you know.
Wow, yeah, yeah.
Look how crucial, and we look back on our own lives, mm-hmm. and look how crucial it was when we did not follow verse 11 and 12. Julie's got 11 and 12 all the way down through about what you want to take it down through 18.
Okay. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects.
Okay.
Just as a father, the son in whom he delights. That's right. Happy is the man who finds wisdom, and the man who gains understanding. For her proceeds are better than the profits of silver, and her gain than fine gold.
Come on.
She is more precious than rubies, and all the things you may desire cannot compare with her. Length of days is in her right hand, and her left hand riches in honor. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. She is a tree of life to those who take hold of her, and happy are all who retain her.
I like that. I like verse 17 right there. You know, all her paths are peace. You know, that's following after that peace. Yeah. I like that.
That's very deliberate there too.
Yeah.
Look at verse 19. Yeah. And this is how we should live. This is how we should operate in life. Look at verse 19. The Lord sets an example in his word right there. You want to read it?
Yeah, it says, the Lord by wisdom had founded the earth. By understanding had he established the heavens. Wow. This is the same wisdom that he's talking about in a few verses up that we need to get, right? And we live in the earth. God founded the earth by his wisdom. If he begin to drop that wisdom in you as you live in the earth, you will conquer the earth.
Amen.
You will win in the earth. And he's willing to drop that those nuggets on you, you know? I think he is. I don't think he's holding back.
And you know, verse 13 and 14, 13, 14, and 15 definitely need to be repeated.
Yeah. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom. So somebody got to go look.
He's searching.
You know, not chilling, watching, you know, TV and with the Coke or whatever. You got to go find looking for this thing. What is it? Wait. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom. And the man that getteth understanding. For the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof than fine gold. Merchandise, what does that mean?
It says gain, for the gain, the merchandise, yeah. The profit. Mm-hmm.
For the merchandise, the result of playing and maneuvering and working with wisdom and utilizing wisdom and exchanging it and doing stuff with it has better reward than silver and gold or whatever else that is good to you. She is more precious than rubies, and all the things thou canst desire are not to be compared.
And that's an amazing statement that what you just read. Yeah. 15, she is more precious than rubies. Who's she
being understanding. Right,
she's being wisdom and understanding.
Wisdom and understanding. Yeah.
Look at what it said. And all the things that thou canst desire are not to be compared unto her.
And we must have wisdom to be able to lead in wisdom.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's any mistake that wisdom is referred to as she. Just saying.
There you go.
You know. Are you sure people
the phone
wanna
just blew up
listen to that right now? I don't think people want to listen to what you just said.
That's true.
Because you see, people always try to make it look like God is this masculine thing. I don't know if they can handle this tonight. God is not masculine. God is feminine. The word, when the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, "I'm Jehovah," what's the surplus God, Jireh? I have more than enough. Here's a ram for you to kill. Jehovah Jireh. That's what he's called himself at that point. And when Jesus started praying and said, "Our Father," the actual prayer in Greek, it says, all-breasted one.
El Shaddai.
Yeah.
Breasty one.
All-breasty one. The man has so many breasts, supply. Lots of them.
That'll mess with some people.
I don't think people want to hear this, so we're probably going to quit. I'm just saying, you know, if you understand what, you know, he's talking about endless provision. Mm.
That nurturing.
That's not a masculine thing. Yeah. It's a feminine character. So anyway, I'll quit. Go ahead, Pastor Mark.
No, very good. Good.
But yeah, she is female.
She is a tree of life.
Look, nothing you can wish for is to be compared to her. So how many things do we wish for, and how many thoughts go through our minds, and how many desires do we work with today? All those desires don't come close to what wisdom can do for you. And, you know, because that conversation began, you know, when these people start talking these things, people are listening. Like when David was giving this thing, he was probably talking to Solomon maybe, or talking to a group of people. Mm-hmm. People's face starts squinting. Like, what are you talking about? Why are you going to say wisdom is all this and all that and all that? And then he now said, let me quantify this. It says wisdom was what God used to found the earth. Is that so? Because you see, people, when you talk this thing, I could see faces like, you know, why are you saying this wisdom is so important? Well, let me tell you, wisdom is what God used to found it. Oh, now people can respect the conversation. You know, it's amazing. Amen. Amen.
In verse 19, we'll break it down into three separate statements there. By wisdom, the Lord founded the earth. The Lord by wisdom founded the earth. Then the next one, understanding. And that's one thing we started out. We was talking about that in such a time like this, we need wisdom, understanding, discernment. We need knowledge. By wisdom, the Lord founded the earth. Get this now. Number two, by understanding, he established the heavens. By knowledge, the depths were broken up and the clouds dropped down the dew. So you've got three separate: wisdom, understanding, and knowledge.
Yes. Yeah.
And I just really believe when you have wisdom, when you get understanding, knowledge is gained.
Yeah.
The fear of the Lord, we receive knowledge, correct? So let's pick up right there. I heard you say just a moment ago, Michael, you talked about verse 18. How about taking it? Let's go ahead let's run this on out through this chapter. Then we'll get on chapter 4 a little bit.
18. She, again, we're talking about wisdom. She is a tree of life to them that lay hold upon her. And happy is everyone that retains her.
Wow.
The Lord by wisdom has founded the earth. By understanding, he established the heavens. By his knowledge, the depths are broken up and the clouds drop down the dew. My son, let not them depart from thine eyes. Keep sound wisdom and discretion. So shall they be life unto thy soul and grace to thy neck. Then shalt thou walk in thy way safely, and thy foot shall not stumble.
Wow.
When thou lie down, thou shalt not be afraid. Yea, thou shalt lie down, and thou shalt sleep. Your sleep will be sweet.
Let's stop right there. How many people struggle and sleeping? Man, it's one of the biggest problems in our lives at time, and there are so many people. And the promise of the Lord right here, that guys, you can take this to heart. This is what the Word of God says. When you lie down, you will not be afraid. Yes, you will lie down, and your sleep will be sweet. And let me tell you something. If you can't sleep good, you can't operate good.
No.
If you don't sleep well, you don't operate well. Bottom line.
Yeah.
And
that's how they push the guys in the military, isn't it? They keep them like in the boot camp and all that stuff, keeping real tired.
Deprivation.
The day I arrived out there, man, 3 days straight, no sleep.
Yeah.
There was activity, activity. There was people were sleepwalking. It don't matter. Keep it moving.
Yeah. And you know, we say all the time that you cannot have rest without peace.
No, you can't.
If you don't have peace, you're not going to rest.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and look, let's go right back to verse 17. We're talking about wisdom, and we're talking about understanding. Her ways are ways of pleasantness. Mm. Say that for me, baby.
Pleasantness.
Okay, and her paths are peace.
Yeah,
that's right.
So when you have peace, you can have rest. And going right back up, verse 24 again, when you lie down, you will not be afraid.
Yeah.
Yes, you. So he gets very specific right there. Yeah. Mm. He says, yes, you will lie down and your sleep will be sweet.
Mm.
In verse 25 and 26, do not be afraid of sudden terror.
Yes,
yesterday was the day that many Americans fell. And a lot of the world fell into sudden terror over what could escalate, what could happen. I know I had several people give me a buzz, and their question was this: are we going to war?
Wow.
I'm afraid we're going to war.
Wow.
And that's, you know, that's sudden terror when you're hit with things.
When you on 23, verse 23 right there, though, that first word, then,
amen,
you know, you got to read, you got to have 1 through 22 first. This means then to get this, you got to get that first.
Hit on 21, 22,
you know, but 20, you know, my son, let not them depart from thine eyes. Them talking about wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. Keep focused on that, right? All right. And then it says, keep sound wisdom and discretion. You know, keep this. Don't let it go.
How do you keep it? Well, he goes all the way back to in the beginning of chapter 1. He tells us to put it around us like a necklace.
That's right.
Okay. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them upon the tablet of your heart.
That's right. You know, it reminds me of when Pastor Mark was talking about when you were on a long fast, and I remember you saying it, and I took this, and he said, I knew if I could take this word and put it in, so make it a part of me. That I danced before the Lord, and I was like, man, that's, you know, and that's it, man. And I share that with guys. I'm like, you got to take this and not just in your head, man, but the tablet of your heart. You got to make it a part of you. You got to get this down inside you.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm glad you mentioned that, because when we started off, like what we just came off of talks about, we got to keep sound wisdom. Don't let it depart from you, which means it can leave you.
You
know, and if you don't keep it, it's going to go away.
Yeah. Well, you can reject it, like you made notice. You talked about how we reject instruction.
And when we started reading, it talks about write it on the tablet. So when we first started, I'm like, how you write? Listen, when I read this stuff, I'll be questioning it.
It's engraved.
How you let the thing engrave in your heart? And then immediately, as I was asking the Spirit that question, the picture of what the Lord told Joshua to do came back to me. Joshua 1. He said, meditate on the word. So like a man that you, if I hit you like this, I say, what's up, man? And you'll be like, you go off of what CNN is saying and all what's Facebook and all this other stuff. Like, there's no word in you. You wasn't meditating on nothing. There was nothing you was walking on, working on in your spirit. When you deal and judiciously keep working on something, the word of God, after a while, that stuff starts printing
on your heart.
Yeah. Amen.
It stays in there.
That's you know. When people say, is that all you talk about?
Yeah, you know. It stays in there. So like when they squeeze you, what comes out is the juice that was sucked up in the in the form.
Yep.
It's like Moses hung out with the Lord. The next thing was God rubbed off on him.
Yeah.
He came down and the people were like, nah, we can't.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned Moses. When we think of Moses, we think of many things.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm. Mighty, mighty prophet of God.
Mm-hmm.
We think about the parting of the Red Sea. We think about his brother Aaron, correct?
Yeah, sister and all.
But we also think one of the biggest things about Moses, we think how his how he spent the time with God on the mountain, right?
Mm.
Separate occasions.
Mm-hmm.
But we also think about him breaking the tablets.
Mm-hmm.
How were the tablets engraved?
Mm.
I mean, in other words, there was pieces of stone.
Right.
God.
How did he do it?
God
wrote
just,
on. He wrote on them with what?
Finger of God.
The finger of his heart.
Yeah.
Now look right here. Go back. We're back to verse 3.
Mm-hmm.
In chapter 3 of Proverbs. Mm. All right. Verse 3 would say, let not mercy and truth forsake you. In other words, don't let them leave you no matter what.
Yeah.
And then he says, bind them around your neck.
Mm.
Write them on the tablet of your heart.
Wow.
On the layers of your heart.
Yeah.
Now turn over to Jeremiah 31.
Mm.
And let's look at verse 31. And we're going to take it down through verse 33. Mm-hmm. And since wisdom is referred to as a lady or a woman, how about Julie reading?
Come back and haunt me a few times.
Jeremiah 31,
too
31.
Late. Too late.
and no, keep the thought now.
Right.
Keep the thought about
writing it on the.
Write them on the tablet of your heart.
Yeah.
God took his finger and wrote upon the stone tablets the commands, correct?
Yeah.
All right. Under the new covenant.
Yeah.
Amen.
Praise God.
We're seeing where the prophet Jeremiah served notice through prophecy the coming of the new covenant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Jeremiah 31:31. A new covenant. Let's start in verse 31. We'll take it down through 30. Well, you can take it through 34.
Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is a covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people.
Come on.
No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and their sin, and I will remember no more.
Amen. So when you accept the Lord Jesus Christ, when you accept the gospel, the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ, that he died on the cross for your sins, that he was buried, that he's risen. When you accept that, the Lord Jesus writes his name of ownership upon the tablet of your heart.
Amen.
Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they're a new creation.
Yeah. Yes.
The old is gone. Behold, all things have become new. In other words, you no longer have ownership of yourself. He takes ownership. And a good example of taking that ownership is in Jeremiah. Let's see. Come on, Lord, here where we're at. Jeremiah 29. Don't. That's wrong. That's wrong. Anyway, we'll get back to that. We'll get back to that. Let's go back to Proverbs, okay? So we talked about how the Lord, we just read in Jeremiah 31 going down, where the Lord wrote upon the tablets of the heart.
Yeah.
Same way he took his finger. And now in Proverbs 3, he's telling us to take the word of God, take wisdom, understanding. Where do we get that? Where do we get wisdom and understanding? Well, you have to go over to James chapter 1.
Yeah.
Amen. And I think in James chapter 1 verse 5, and it tells how to get wisdom. But let me tell you something. Spend time in God's word, you will get wisdom.
That's right.
Cry out for wisdom.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. That's true.
You're at James chapter 1.
Yeah. If James 1:5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that gives to all men and women liberally.
Yeah.
And upbraideth not.
How does he give it?
Liberally.
Freely.
Yeah, freely. Abundantly.
Abundantly. See, so there's no lack on his part trying to do this thing.
No.
He wants to, right?
He that one. He does. He desires to.
Yeah.
Exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think.
And who did he say he would give it to?
All men and women.
See?
All.
Everyone. You are entitled. If you are human.
Yeah.
It's not going to demons.
No.
It's not going to aliens if you think they are out there. It's funny. How will God, anyway, I ain't going to alien stuff. But he will give it to you.
Yes, right.
Liberally.
Well, we got to ask.
Yeah.
We just got
to
ask.
You got to come to him as a son and a daughter boldly.
Mm-hmm.
And ask for the thing.
I remember Mark, it's probably about this time last year. I remember him saying, and I'm like, when I first started coming out to the Bible study, two years ago, I couldn't find anything in the Bible without going to the front of the book. This is why I had to find everything in the Bible 2 years ago. I'd be like, hold on, man. Let me see here. That's in the Old Testament.
Right.
And this is how I found everything 2 years ago.
Wow.
And I remember coming out to the Bible study, and Mark's like a Bible. You know, he's just like a human Bible.
Yeah.
You know, and he's like, and I'm like, how in the world does he do this? Right. And then he said, I remember him saying, he says, you got to pray. You got to pray and ask for reference, recall, recite, revelation. So I was like, all right. Well, I started praying for it. I started asking for it. You know?
Yeah.
And it worked.
And you know,
well, you've done your part too.
Yeah. If you write it, and how it gets in there, you know, you meditate on that thing until it becomes a part of your breathing spirit. It's like your spirit now acknowledges that piece of revelation, that word.
Mm.
Guess what? It's not going to leave you.
That's right.
It's not. It's going to cough out of you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whenever the spirit wants it to come out of you, it will come out.
Yeah. It's, when you said that, you know, I was talking to somebody the other day, and they were, you know, I was telling them, and they were like, man, I can't remember. And that's what, and I said, if you read this and you continue to eat this and put it down in there, it ain't really for you all the time. It's for your spirit. Mm. And then it's what you said, when you need it, all of a sudden it comes back, and you're like, man, where'd that come from?
Yeah. The spirit knows how to eat it, not you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And he brings it back up.
He knows how to eat it because it's his food.
Amen.
Have you ever put something
in front of food of heaven.
Yeah. You ever put something in front of a hog, like a piece of potato, cooked potato, and he's like, how do we eat potato? You don't ask those kind of questions. The spirit knows how to eat the word.
Amen.
You gotta provide it.
Yeah. Yep.
Once you start reading, even if you fall asleep, get up and continue.
Yeah.
Sooner or later, your spirit will take over, and you won't fall asleep anymore.
Yeah.
let's get out an announcement about our special guest coming next week, and we'll start. Let's go over 25 and run it through 35.
Okay.
Yep. Because we got to go to chapter one real quick to make a note of something. Okay.
Yep.
Special guest next week,
Nancy Haney,
and she will be having the Point to Hope.
Women's Conference. Sure, is that the one?
Yeah. Well, she's gonna be here. She's gonna be in the state. She's from Alaska.
Yeah,
and she's in the state. She's ministering around here. She'll be at, I don't exactly remember what day she's gonna be at Grace Place. It's not, but she's gonna be here on the radio next Wednesday. So, guys, you wanna tune in for this. It's gonna be a good show.
And also having, we'll make announcements. Mm-hmm. Having a big conference in Aiken.
Yeah.
At River of Life Church. Yeah. We'll get those. I think it's the, what, 23rd, 24th?
I think so.
Yeah.
But we'll get dates out. Starts Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll post those dates later online for you guys.
You don't want to miss next week.
Yeah.
Nancy is just awesome.
She is also going to be at Marvin United Methodist Church, 17, 18, 19.
Okay.
All mornings and evenings, 17, 18, 19. Marvin, okay. United Methodist Church.
Amen.
Somewhere in town.
Look at the good news of verse 26. Michael, start right there on 25, and let's run that out.
Proverbs chapter 3, verse 25. You guys got your Bibles, follow along. Be not afraid of sudden fear, neither of the desolation of the wicked when it comes. For the Lord shall be the confidence and shall keep thy foot from being taken.
Come on.
Withhold not good from them to whom it is due, when it is in the power of thine hand to do it. Say not unto thy neighbor, go and come again, and tomorrow I will give thee when thou hast it by thee. Devise not evil against thy neighbor, seeing he dwells securely by thee. Strive not with a man without cause, if he have done thee no harm. Envy thou not the oppressor, and choose none of his ways. For the froward is abomination to the Lord, but his secret is with the righteous. The curse of the Lord is in the house of the wicked, but he blesses the habitation of the just. Surely he scorns the scorners, but he gives grace unto the humble.
Come on.
The wise shall inherit glory, but shame shall be the promotion of fools.
I want to hit on verse 32 right there out of the New King James. It says, mm-hmm. For the perverse person is an abomination to the Lord, but his secret counsel is with the upright. Who's the upright?
Yes,
the ones that have accepted Christ Jesus as Lord and Savior.
That's right.
Who have become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Now let's jump over to verse chapter 1 real quickly as we started this out. And we've got to go the beginning of knowledge. Proverbs chapter 1 verse 1.
The Proverbs of Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, to know wisdom and instruction, to perceive the words of understanding, to receive the instruction of wisdom, justice, and judgment and equity, to give subtlety to the simple, to the young man knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear, and the young will increase learning. And a man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsels. To understand a proverb and the interpretation, the words of the wise and their dark sayings.
And verse 7 would say, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and knowledge. Look back at verse 3 again. To receive instruction of wisdom, justice, judgment, and what is that, equity?
Mm-hmm.
To give prudence to the simple, and to the young man knowledge and discretion, right?
Mm-hmm.
Verse 5, a wise man will hear and increase learning, and a man of understanding will attain wise counsel. Mm.
I love that one when you read in that verse 32, for the froward is abomination to the Lord, but his secret is with the righteous. And immediately my spirit was like,
yeah,
if I'm righteous, his secret is with me.
Yeah.
Am I using those secrets?
Yeah.
He's going to give and reveal the secrets.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Am I using those secrets? Because they're giving it to me for something, not just to keep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Am I using them in my poverty situation? Am I using them in my relationship situation, in my job, about my health, about my, just whatever comes at me? Am I using those secrets? Because I have them. They're in my spirit. He downloaded that stuff.
And he's going to give them.
Yeah.
That's he's right. going to give them when you need them.
Yeah.
It's like a personal trainer. Mm-hmm. And I'm not referring to the Holy Spirit of God as a personal trainer, but he's there.
Right.
And to give, and in some ways he is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He's the comforter.
That's right. Yeah,
yeah. And
that's
when you need to do something, he whispers. Mm-hmm. Honey, would you read the call of wisdom? And we'll carry over. We'll switch it. But it's starting at verse 20, and we'll run it down through 33. So we've been talking about wisdom, knowledge, understanding, and discernment. So wisdom calls out.
Yes, in the streets. This is so much available. It's calling.
Wisdom calls aloud outside. She raises her voice in the open squares.
Yes.
She cries out in the chief concourses. Mm. At the openings of the gates in the city, she speaks her words. How long, you simple ones, will you love simplicity? For scorners delight in their scorning, and fools hate knowledge. Turn at my rebuke. Surely I will pour out my spirit on you, and I will make my words known to you, because I have called you and you refused. I've stretched out my hand and no one regarded. Because you disdained all my counsel and would have none of my rebuke, I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your terror comes, like a storm, and your destruction comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you.
Wow, it's crying out. So like, it's like solution is out there ready to go. Can you tap into it?
Guys, listen, Facebook, don't go anywhere. If you're listening on the air, we're out of time, and we thank you for tuning in. If you're listening on there and you want to catch the rest of this program, you can get on Facebook and you can check out The Way 99.9. You can also check it out on YouTube. It'll be on YouTube after the program. But guys, if you're listening, we'll see you next week. Facebook, stay with us. We'll be right back.
There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker.
Yes, he is.
If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, your savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. Oh, he's a chain breaker.
Facebook, thanks for staying with us.
We need to run that chapter on out.
Sorry. I was trying to laugh at Crystal's comment.
Praise God.
What's
praise
up, Bill
God.
Turner? Yeah. All right. Yeah. Where are we at here, guys?
Wow. Verse 28, I think.
Verse 28.
Proverbs chapter 1, if you're just tuning in from home. Talking about wisdom, understanding, knowledge.
Then they will call on me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but they will not find me. Because
bad.
They hated knowledge and did not choose the fear of the Lord.
Choose.
Ooh, they would have none of my counsel and despised me, excuse me, my every rebuke. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their own way and be filled to the full with their own fancies. For the turning away of the simple will slay them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. But whoever listens to me will dwell safely and will be secure without fear of evil.
Look at verse 31. Look at, can't Man, I tell you what. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their own way. My gosh.
I don't think I want
that. And you know what that is? That's death.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's death.
Yeah.
It's the fruit of death, your own way.
Yeah. Yeah.
They choose. They refuse to choose her. They have different ways of explaining it away. Now, you know, I don't like that kind of preaching. You know, I don't like what that person is saying. You know, we don't like that. You choose to say no to wisdom, and it's crying out in the streets.
And notice it said concourses. How many, you know, we've all been to the airport in Atlanta.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people in a concourse, right? Yeah. Concourse, what, E? We go E and F a lot, but, you know, it.
Yeah.
Bunch of people.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Wisdom is constantly crying out because it's the heart of God.
Well, in verse 28,
it's who God is.
Verse 28 says, then shall they call upon me, but I will not answer. Calling upon the Lord, he will not answer.
What verse is that again?
Verse 28.
Before they started calling and he didn't answer, they did some things first.
Yeah.
Wisdom. They rejected.
When you ask me, like, wisdom, when you're trying to find the way and you reject it,
because we can insult the Lord.
Yeah.
You see, a lot of people think, you know, whenever I want to, then I can get to God. There's a day you might want to get to God, you won't find the Lord.
Yeah.
Because the Lord ain't there waiting on you all day, all night for 50 years.
Look at verse 29. Because they hated knowledge.
Yeah. Because.
Yeah.
And did not choose the fear of the Lord.
Yeah.
What would be a good representation of that? Fear there, I think if we looked at it, would be a reverential awe or a respect.
Mm. Yeah.
Okay. How do we know God most? We know him. Romans chapter 1 would tell us about creation. Man is without excuse. There's no excuse to say there's not a God. You can simply know it by creation.
Yeah.
Romans 1 is clear about that. But we know God by his word. Okay. They did not choose to fear the fear of the Lord. In other words, we did not respect or believe his word.
Yeah. We rejected his word.
Word.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember Jesus said something one time about, oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. How has, you know, something, you know, I came to you, but you didn't recognize your time of visitation. People would take it for granted.
Look at. Go ahead and run it on out and really hit on 33 again and look at the promise of 33. Start on 30, Michael, and take it on down again.
This is Proverbs chapter 1, verse 30. They would none of my counsel. They would have none of my counsel. They despised all my reproof.
Now, let's stop right there. Now, what does he tell us in chapter 3? He says, in verse 1, he says, my son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands.
Yeah.
And then he goes in verse 5, he says, trust in the Lord, lean not unto your own understanding.
Yeah.
And when we lean to our own understanding, a lot of times, well, let me just say this. We can only trust our own understanding if it is an alignment and a replica of God's word. If it reflects God's word. So he says right here, they would have none of my counsel.
Yeah.
God's word is our counsel. And going over, so how would we look at that? We have in Psalms chapter 1, verse 1 down through verse 3, a Christian or anybody else, you can tell when you're going to get in hot water. When you fall in alignment with one of those scriptures in Psalms chapter 1, verse 1 through, what does it say? Blessed is the man.
Is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper.
In other words, that tree is alive.
Yep. Amen.
Amen.
Yep.
So that's how we look when I've seen myself out of whack. In other words, got off the right path. I can look back at one of those three separate things listed there. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. If it's an area that I fell off in, that I will see where I've took worldly advice, worldly counsel, and rejected God's word.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you something. Don't take you long. You'll be in a mess.
But that's
Go ahead.
I was just thinking, what it reminds me of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And it talks about not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but the Holy Ghost teaches.
Right.
That's wisdom of the Holy Ghost.
That's what I was going to say, but not as strong as you said it. It was. No, because the truth about it is people are listening to stuff.
Yeah.
But that thing you're listening to, if it cannot bring you out, then you're not getting that wisdom. You're getting something.
Yeah.
Ain't that wisdom, though.
Mm-mm.
Because what you're listening to matters.
Yeah.
So we're not to listen to worldly ways or wisdom, right? Yeah. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. You know, there's all kinds of, you know, you can do this. Then they'll throw that one in there. And that one is, everybody does it.
Yeah.
You can do it. Everybody does it.
Yeah.
No.
And then he says, blessed is he who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you're standing right in mess in a bunch of mess. Blessed is the man who, go ahead and read it.
Blessed.
I have to start quoting it all the way from the top.
Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly,
nor stands
in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful.
Wow. That's just like the seat of a judge making a declaration that person is of no worth value.
Speaking death over somebody.
Yeah. Could be.
It's like
demise.
It's like also like sit in the sinner's scornful. So the production of this seat is scorn. You identify with it. You go there and sit and identify. Yeah, we're
making together. A judgment.
Yeah,
it's a place of authority.
Yeah,
you're making a judgment and a declaration or decree concerning someone or an issue.
Yeah,
what is it? Blessed is the person who sits not in the seat of the scornful.
Yeah. Yeah.
Finds that person of no value. Yeah. In other words, they're
trying to put
I deem you're worthless.
Instead of getting low and pushing them up. Yeah.
That's a very, very dangerous place to be in. A place of scorn.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I like the other one too that says, walks not in the counsel of the ungodly.
Mm-hmm.
You're practicing, you're walking in. You will experience experimenting and or carrying out instructions of the ungodly, and the result is not blessed, because the person that gets the blessed is the person that does not do that.
Yeah.
So if what you're doing ain't bringing blessing, you might be getting wrong. You might be walking in wrong counsel.
Yeah.
Well, you're cursing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, it may sound good. It might sound good. It might sound right. It might have worked for somebody else. That don't mean it has to work for you, because you should get the result. Blessed.
Yeah.
Blessed is the result.
You know, see, I don't know. I'm going to put this out there for somebody. This is not the reason we do this. We don't do this for the blessings. We do this because we love Jesus. This is the result of loving Jesus. You know, I think a lot of people are, you know, and I've heard this a few times, a lot of people are doing this because they want the blessings more than the blessor. You know,
and those blessings aren't always material.
That's right. You know,
a wounded spirit, who can bear? Man, after you've had the peace of God,
yeah,
you sure don't want the distress,
yeah,
of the wicked.
No.
Mm-mm. Or just being without the presence of the Lord.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, that peace that comes with that.
Yeah. Yeah. Man, that's all we've been searching for our entire lives is peace.
That's right.
You know? So what verse are we on here?
Where are we back at? Proverbs?
Proverbs chapter 1.
Okay. Well, we read the call of wisdom all the way down through
we go back.
How far did we get on that? Proverbs 1.
I think we're done.
We started in verse 20.
Yeah. Michael read it all the way down to
33. Yep. All right. But
we wanted to pick back up on 30 and run it down and double hit tap on 33.
Okay. All right. Julie?
They would have none of my counsel and despised my every rebuke. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their own way and be filled to the full with their own fancies. For the turning away of the simple will slay them, and the complacency of fools will destroy them. But whoever listens to me will dwell safely and will be secure without fear of evil. There's that promise.
Come on. Yeah. You know, I love how God sets it out. Yeah, there's two trees in the garden, man. God's like, and he makes it so plain. And if people are like, man, I don't understand why this stuff happened to me. Man, God, he sets it out like this. He's like, look, he loves us unconditionally, man. But he puts it out. He's like, look, if you choose this, this is what you get. But if you choose this, this is what you get. And then when we choose wrong, we're like, why is this happening?
Exactly. We're so hard-headed.
It's like, well, he told you. Oh, man. It's so simple. I've missed it for a long time, though.
Let's turn over to Psalm 16, but we want to I want to reiterate on verse 31 of Proverbs 1. It says, therefore they shall eat the fruit of their own way and shall be filled to the full with their own fancies. I want you to think about that. Now let's turn over to Psalm 16, and I want to start in verse 1, and we're really going down to verse 4. Psalm 16, verse 1, but we're going to hit on verse 4 in reference to Proverbs 1:31, where it says, therefore they shall eat the fruit of their own way and be filled to the full with their own fancies. All right. Verse 1 of Psalm 16 would say, preserve me, O God, for in you I put my trust. O my soul, you have said to the Lord. Now think about soul. I don't think the word there applies. You could think normally when we think of soul in the Greek, it would be mind, will, and emotion.
Yep.
Okay. O my soul, you have said to the Lord, you are my Lord. My goodness is nothing apart from you. Verse 3. As far as the saints who are on the earth, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. That's Jehovah God saying that right there. Okay. Verse 4. Their sorrows shall be multiplied who hasten after another God. I want you now, in a thought that I want to interject. When I make myself an idol or a god and put myself above God, okay, we normally look as an idol anything that's above that we put before God, okay? In other words, if there's a choice, God here, me and my ways, my thoughts, my intents, my opinion, my thinking, and I choose my way over God's way, I make myself a god. In other words, I worship myself. I have self-righteousness. Now look what it says. Their sorrows shall be multiplied who hasten after another god. And it's a direct reference to what we read in Proverbs 1:31. Therefore, they shall eat the fruit of their own way. Be careful when we put our own opinion, our wants, our will, and our way above God's word, God's will, God's way, because you're going to get what you got.
That's right. It's the truth.
I'm serious.
Yep.
Their sorrows shall be multiplied. Now get that. Who hasten after another god. Now that's dangerous business. That's dangerous business. Very serious business. When I choose my own way of thinking and make myself a god above God's word. Amen? I'm seriously, it's dangerous. It's dangerous. I just wanted to throw that in there. Let's go ahead and run. Let's start. Verse 4, start right there, Michael, in verse 4. We'll just start from the top again, or whoever wants to read it.
Psalm 16.
You want to read it? Psalm 16, verse 1. And I want to look at the promises, especially when you get down toward verse 9, 10, and 11. I mean, all the way through here, you're going to start seeing just the revelation of God.
Yeah, King James says, "Preserve me, O God, for indeed I put my trust." That not everybody can say that, though. Some people have trust in other things. Oh, my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, "Thou art my Lord; my goodness extended not to thee." So the soul can speak. But to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent in whom is all my delight, their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasten after another god, small g. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. The Lord is the portion of mine inheritance and of my cup. Thou maintainest my lot. You know, everybody has a cup. Have you ever heard a sermon like that? Everybody has a cup.
Yep.
Everybody, human being, has a cup. It's right. Filled with something. Or it has something in it. It might not be filled. It might be filled. It might not be filled. It might. It's never empty, though. Something is always in the cup of every person. My cup runneth over. That's your cup. Runs over with something. In that verse is great things. Jesus talked about a cup. He said, "There is a cup that is prepared for me." You see, there was a cup prepared for Christ.
Amen.
And when the two guys came with their mothers or mother and wanted to take the right and the left, he said, "Can you drink the cup that I'm about to drink?" Everybody has a cup. This kind of messages don't preach them no more. You know, like everybody has a cup. What you mean? Yeah, everybody has a cup. Look at the Bible.
Some people would refer to that as a cup of suffering.
Yeah.
That's right. People always think it's always a cup because Jesus had a cup to drink, and his cup that was prepared for him was the cross.
Mm-hmm. He learned obedience.
But there's other cups that, you know, that come to you. You know, so like in, you know, in this case, it talks about, what did it talk about that cup? This cup here was, what verse is that?
5.
The Lord is the portion of mine inheritance and of my cup. Thou maintainest my lot. 6. The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places.
Come on.
The lines are falling to me in pleasant places. That's a blessing. That's one of the things I think Pastor Mark is trying to draw us to.
Yeah.
The lines are falling for you. So the lines might not fall in pleasant places. They need to fall in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage.
Mm. I want to throw something back on this cup.
Yeah, yeah, go for it.
Would you rather Jesus fix you a cup of tea?
Yeah.
Or Satan brew you a batch? Yeah, yeah. I want you to think about this.
Yeah.
Look at that. Yeah. I've never looked at it in that way. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
It says, "Oh Lord, you are my," verse 5, "you are the portion of my inheritance and cup."
Yeah.
"You maintain my lot."
Yeah.
"The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places." And the question is for us and you at home, would you rather Jesus brew your tea or the devil to brew you a batch, yours? Mm. That's a cup.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think he would put in it? What do you think he would put in it? I can tell you what he would put in it. Going back to verse 4, and I'm gonna just throw this in there real quick so Yohani can get back on picking up at verse 5 again.
Yeah.
"But their sorrows shall be multiplied who hasten after another God." Mm. Let's just take this, stay in this vein, that we put ourselves above God.
Yeah.
That we put ourselves above God's word. We reject the word of God, and every one of us did that.
Yeah.
In a time and season in our life.
Yeah.
So we're not just directing this to you at home like we never did. I rejected the word of God. I discounted. I did not believe the word of God. I chose to lean to my own understanding.
Mm-hmm.
In Colossians chapter 2:3 would start out in verse 1. It would say, "Not carnality, but Christ." And he says right here in verse 1, just to leading up, we're going to verse 5, 6, and 7.
Mm.
But he says, "If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above."
Yes.
In other words, I was seeking the things that I knew.
Mm.
I was following my heart.
Mm.
And people say, "Well, just trust your heart." Let me tell you something. That's the most ungodly statement ever made. Because when I followed my heart, there wasn't nothing but death in it.
Depends on what heart you got.
What is that, Jeremiah? "My heart was deceitful, wicked above all things."
So he says in verse 1, not carnality of Colossians 3:1, "But then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above." Where does the word? The word of God is the inspired word from above, the inspired word of God, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God.
Yep.
Verse 2, "Set your mind on the things above and not on the things of the earth. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God." Verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will appear with him. Then you also will appear with him in glory.
Yes.
We're going to verse 5. Mm. When I make myself an idol, when I make myself above God, how do I do that?
Mm.
By rejecting Christ Jesus, by rejecting God, by rejecting the word of God, and say like this, "Stay in the car, Jesus, I got the beer."
Yeah.
You know, I used to tell my buddies when we were riding around all the time, stay in the car, I'll get the beer. You know, I've got this thing.
Yeah. Thanks, this Jesus. Is how I like it. I like it like this.
I got it from here.
Yeah. You know, the people liking themselves, people like, this is how I like to do my Christianity.
Yeah. And notice, now going, I know we're jumping around. And we're talking about now Psalm 16, verse 4.
Yeah.
It says, their sorrows shall be multiplied, who hasten after another God.
Yeah.
Some translations would say, much sorrow to those who hasten after another God. By the instead of the true and living God, God Jehovah, God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. Look at verse 5 of Colossians chapter 3. It says, therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanliness, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. In other words, putting ourselves above God.
Yeah.
Okay? Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience. Now, get this. People say, oh, well, I've got all that covered. Look at verse 7. In which you yourself once walked when you lived in them.
Yep.
And, you know, we have to die daily. We have to crucify. I do. Oh, I mean, and I don't.
People don't want you to say that kind of stuff.
And when we don't, we sin. Yeah. When I don't, I sin.
People don't like that message.
Yeah.
You need to change that topic. That's not what people like to hear today.
Yep. But look at verse 8. But now you yourselves are put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Verse 9, do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds. Verse 10, and have put on the new man, who is renewed in the knowledge according to the image of him. Talking about the person of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Who created him. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, slave nor free, but Christ in all and in all. Then he goes on the character of a new man. The character of a new man in verse 12 would be, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering. Long-suffering, bearing with one another. Get this now. Golly. Bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you must also do. In forgiveness.
That forgiveness is important. I mean, that's a command. Yeah.
Verse 14. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection. So when we make ourselves a god, in other words, an idol, a god, much sorrow to those, going back to 16, Psalm 16, 4. Get ready. You're fixing to get blistered.
Yeah.
Seriously. Whether it be me, you, or anybody else, much sorrow is to those who hasten after another God. And go ahead.
I just want to say real quick before we get off this Colossians, I just wanted to say just this next verse in 15.
Yeah.
By doing everything Mark just read, 15 says, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Just wanted to get that in there.
Yeah,
you did. Well, the peace of God only comes from the presence of God.
Well, that's it. Yeah. That's right.
And let's turn over to John. Let's turn over to we talk about how the Holy Spirit, the relationship with Jesus and the Holy Spirit in John chapter, let's look at 16.
Yeah. I was just thinking, somebody can be asking the question, how do you crucify the flesh? That would be a good thing to teach. Because we, you know, people got the instruction, crucify the flesh, but how do you do it? You know? Because somebody might want to crucify their flesh.
Yeah.
Remember, we've got to remember that we died with Christ.
That's right.
Amen. That's I am crucified. What is that? Galatians what? 2:20?
Yep.
I am crucified. I'm crucified with Christ.
It's no longer me.
No longer I that lives, but Christ that lives within me. Mm. And the life I now live, I live by faith in the one who loved me. Get that. Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. Who loved me and gave himself for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You do that daily.
Yeah.
Say you die. We die.
Is that what it is?
That's right. That's 220? Exactly right. Yeah. You know, it ain't about me no more.
Yeah. Even though we're supposed to already be dead.
Yeah.
We obviously just keep reviving ourselves.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Oh, you're going to make all these people go off a line. They're going down. See, this thing should be, people should be coming up. They're going down. I don't think they like that kind of stuff.
They're like, wait, I got to crucify myself. I got to die. Oh, whoa.
Daily, too.
Yeah. Oh, we talked about long suffering. Yeah. I don't want to talk about that.
So think about it this way. Paul was saved. Yeah. But then he later on says, I die daily.
Yeah.
So you saved, you died with Christ, rose with him. But then he still says, I got to do this every day.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it talks about, I present my body a living sacrifice.
Yeah.
Sacrifice is not fun.
Yep.
When you walk away from what you know you would have loved to do because you are your God.
Mm.
When you walk away and deny and say no at every count that it comes on you.
Yeah.
The picture, the comment, the somebody said, somebody, whatever. When you say no, you killing the flesh.
Yeah.
You presenting a living sacrifice. What happens on sacrifices? Something gets slaughtered.
Yeah.
Blood comes out. And then fire comes upon the thing. Oh, by the way, in the Old Testament, God loved the smell of flesh.
Mm.
He loved burnt offerings.
He did.
And then the New Testament, can I keep going on? Is this too
bad? Yeah, we already lost the last.
you know what I'm saying? Crucify the flesh. You know, this thing, you know, we talk about it too fast sometimes.
Mm.
In the Old Testament, God loved the smell of flesh. They would kill burnt offering. God would be like, yeah, bring it. Like the blood. Solomon killed 1,000 of them things. God showed up in his room. What do you want, son? He was like, yeah. Because flesh is the enemy of God.
Mm. Mm.
Flesh is the direct enemy of God. Mm-hmm. Flesh never wants to do what God wants.
Yeah.
And God is like, burn it. Kill the thing. You know, flesh is only good for dying.
Yeah.
It's not good for the sex, the beard, flesh is not good for none of that, but for death.
That's good. That's
okay. I mean, I can't stop. Because the things are going down. They should be going up.
You talked about crucifying the flesh. Turn over to Romans chapter 5.
Oh.
Okay. Romans chapter 5.
Verse 8.
And we're going to start in verse 12.
Mm-hmm.
And Michael, pick it up.
Romans
get
5,
Julie 12. To take 12 all the way down through 21, and then we're going to pick up Romans chapter 6,
mm-hmm.
and you're going to run it out to verse 1 through 10 in chapter 6.
Okay,
but let's go ahead in verse 12 of Romans 5.
You said 12 through 21.
Yeah,
please. Yes.
Therefore, just as through one man sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all sinned. For until law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even those who had not sinned, according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam, who is a type of him who was to come. But the free gift is not like the offense. For if by the one man's offense many died, much more the grace of God and the gift by the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, abounded to many. And the gift is not like that which came through the one who sinned. For the judgment which came from one offense resulted in condemnation, but the free gift which came from many offenses resulted in justification.
Yes, Lord.
For if by the one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one Jesus Christ.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
Therefore, as through one man's offense judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so, through one man's righteousness act, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. For by as one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience many will be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace abounded much more, so that as sin reigned in death, even so grace might reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. All right, chapter 6.
Let's hit on verse 18. You know, there's a lot of people say, well, I'm a good person. I give to the church and the local fire department and all that. There's nothing wrong with that. And verse 18 said, would say, therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men. In verse 14, going back up, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who had not sinned according to the likeness of the transgression of Adam. You know, we were born in a sinful state. Amen?
Oh, yeah.
Death did not come by any personal sin as it did in the case of Adam. Death came upon all men because of Adam. I've got that little note I wrote to myself right there. Death came upon all because of Adam. Verse 18 again. You must, well, I've been a good guy. I pay my taxes. I help my neighbor and all that. But the question is Jesus Christ your Lord and your Savior?
That's right.
Verse 18, therefore, as through one man's offense, let's not talking football, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation. Even so, through one man's righteousness, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. Have you accepted the free gift that God offered through Jesus Christ? That's the question. You know, it's a free gift.
That's right.
You know, it was free. Yes. It's free.
Yes.
Yeah. Why are you working hard about it?
Yeah. And there's so many people in me thought, you know, I'm a good guy.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. You were starting verse 1 of chapter 6 of Romans, correct?
Yeah. Yeah. You know, when you receive that gift, you know, and we hit on this in Proverbs too, talking about saints. When you receive that gift, I hear this a lot. It's that we're all sinners.
Oh, you are, not me.
You are until you get born again.
Yeah, you know.
When you get born again and you make Jesus Christ the Lord and He's the King, you become a saint, but you don't die to become a saint. The saints are alive.
You become a new creation.
New creation.
The old
is past.
Is gone.
Is gone.
Yeah.
Behold,
all things.
But you know, people get offended with that. You know that?
Yeah, I know.
They get real mad at you. Like, oh, so you saying you good? You know, you ain't done nothing bad, or you don't do stuff.
Yeah.
They get so mad at you. Why are you mad at me, man? Like, mad at the word. Don't be mad at me.
And I didn't say that. This is what
I
love.
I was told that.
I love chapter 6 because they all like, we're all sinners. Well, no, you just don't want to be convicted of your sin. It's like, you know, I'm a saint that may sin. Mm. I'm not saying I never sin. Mm. But I'm no longer a sinner. I'm no bad. Well, we'll just.
What read. Is actually sinning? It's to miss the
to
mark.
To miss the mark. Mm. That's right. Mm. You know, and that's the thing. It's that willful sin, that living in that willful sin. When I know it ain't right, I continue to do it and try to sear my conscience with a hot iron. Mm. Then, you know, I'm not comfortable in that anymore. Mm. But, you know, I'll just read.
And the Holy Spirit. He convicts of sin, righteousness,
that's right.
Yes, and judgment.
Yeah,
judgment. He's the Spirit of Truth. He will guide into all truth. And you go back to Psalm 16. See how we've been running this around? Psalm 16 says that, you know, He's our cup.
That's
Come
right.
on. He's our inheritance.
Yes.
So we're talking.
I'll take that.
We're talking about crucifying the flesh, right?
Yes.
That's you know, we had to get that.
Yeah.
John 3:16, 17 and 18, and Romans 5:20 is good news.
Yes.
But where sin abounded, come on, preacher, grace abounded much greater.
Yeah.
Much more.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, Romans chapter 6, verse 1.
It says, what shall we say then?
Is there anything else to talk about? I mean, what else you want to hear? Go ahead.
Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?
Mm.
God forbid.
Mm.
How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?
Yeah.
Know ye not? Do you not know that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life.
By that same glory that raised him. That glory that raised him can also carry you to walk in the new life.
Amen.
What makes you walk this walk is the same glory of God that raised Christ from the dead. Why?
Amen.
He rose the dead body. We got dead bodies.
Yeah.
That glory can come and make you alive. And he said, don't you know?
Yeah.
See the problem? What do you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you know?
And what do you believe?
Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, that's right.
If you know the way he's saying it, that glory that raised Christ comes and raises you.
Yeah.
That's why Romans 8 is two chapters ahead.
Yeah, yeah.
Verse 11 or so, it talks about if the same spirit that raised him from the dead dwells in you, it will quicken your body.
Yeah.
That dead body, it will cause it to come alive.
Yeah, that's right. Amen. Amen. He says in Romans 6, picking back up at verse 5, for if, that means you got a choice, for if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dies no more. Death hath no more dominion over him.
Yes, Lord.
Verse 10.
For in that he died unto sin once, but come in on. That he lives unto God.
All right, verse 10 in the New King James would say, for the death that he died to sin once and for all. Once
I'll take it.
For all.
Yeah. I'll take it.
But the life that he lives to God.
Yes.
Verse 11, likewise, you also reckon yourself to be dead
indeed,
sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Yes, Lord. Reckon yourself.
Verse 12, baby.
Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey it in its lusts. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God.
I have a dear friend, and he writes songs. And he calls me at times, and I'm telling you what, he's got there must be a wire straight from heaven hooked into his ear. And he called me, and I was struggling one day, and he actually called me the other day. And I just somewhat have been overwhelmed, but he called me one time and he said, Lord had me write a song. And he said, I'm supposed to sing it to you. And you know what the name of that song was?
What?
Don't Give Life to a Dead Man.
Don't resurrect that dead man.
Don't give life to a dead man. And he sung it, and he went all the way through it. We need to get him on here one night. And he called me the other day, and he said, and the Lord gave me another song.
What was the name of that one?
I shared it with you. I can't remember. You know, dead men don't vote.
Yeah.
Well, except in a couple elections we've had here.
We'll get into all that today. You know?
But anyway, a dead man has no rights.
Yeah.
So let's wrap this out. Let's turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. God.
Hallelujah.
verse 19. So the truth of the word is that if you've accepted Christ, you've died with him, according to what we just read in scripture, right?
That's right.
In other words, we're already crucified.
Yeah.
Okay. We just got to remember that we're a dead man.
Go
is
reckon.
That the best way to put it?
Reckon it, mortify it every day.
Yes.
Put to death the activity of the members.
Mm. Notice this. A dead man can't make decisions.
That's right.
He's dead.
Yeah. So don't.
Dead men can't process. Well, am I going to believe this word, Lord, or am I? You know, we're dead.
Wow.
That's right.
Just say, you know, oh,
dead men don't have a vote.
That's right. We just check with God.
Just be like, oh, sorry, never mind. I'm dead. I didn't even know what I was saying.
Praise God. All right, guys. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19.
And we're talking about being dead now.
Verse 19 says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you are not your own? For you, verse 20, for you are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's.
Wow. No. See, no came back around. Know ye not? Do you know that? How come my body ain't doing like his temple? Do you know?
Yeah.
Do you know the Holy Ghost? You see, do you know? Do you know that the God of heaven wants to abide with you? Do you know? Do you know the Holy Ghost is the one that can make this happen?
That's right.
Do you like Holy Ghost or you don't like Holy Ghost?
I love the Holy Ghost.
Well, I love Holy Ghost, but I hate tongues. Well, I can't. We're not going to.
Well, we made a statement earlier, and I think I said we would turn back to Jeremiah 31. I talked about how God, how Christ Jesus writes upon the tablet of our heart. We've seen that in Jeremiah 31. All the way through verse 34. And if you want to see a perfect example of that in Scripture, you would look in chapter 32 of Jeremiah, where Jeremiah redeemed the land. So maybe we can hit on that sometime next week. But it's a real beautiful, beautiful picture how the Lord Jesus wrote his name upon the tablet of our heart. And we just read in 1 Corinthians 6:19-20 where he took ownership.
That's right.
You know, there was a deed. With the ownership, you got a deed. And a deed is recorded, and a deed is kept in a safe place. You keep your deeds, hopefully, in a fireproof place at your house. But also, there's a copy of that deed. Okay.
Yep, that's right.
I love that. I just have to say, because of each, as each of us have sat here and made notes in our Bible and underlined it, we did that because we own these Bibles. These Bibles belong to us.
Come on.
That's why we're writing on them.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah, that's good.
Amen. So, in Jeremiah 32, you will see where Jeremiah was the redeemer. And you'll see about two vessels.
Yeah.
Okay. Maybe we'll get into that. You know, I need time to explain it. It's about purchasing the land.
That's right.
And see, we just read in 1 Corinthians 6:19-20 where we were purchased. And what we were purchased with was the blood of Christ.
That's right.
So, and we're not our own. We're his. We were bought with a price.
That's right.
And then he signed the deed, the ownership.
Yeah, that's right.
And there's two places that Jesus writes ownership. One is the tablet of our heart, and the other is when our name is written in the book of life in heaven.
That's right.
There will be one put on display for everybody to see.
That's right.
I want to get into that maybe.
Next.
And it's a perfect example how a deed was kept. They would put a deed in an earthen vessel. Okay? And it would be on display like at the city gate. You'd walk in the city gate and there'd be earthen vessels. And everybody could go and pull the stopper on one of them and look if the deed was in order. They could check the deed out. Then there was also one kept in a safe place. What's this body made of? Earthen vessel? It's made out of clay. The ownership, the contract, the covenant. Notice we talked about the new covenant, the signing of it, the Lord said. There was one that was put in public display, and then there was a copy that was put in a safe place. Is there any place safer than heaven? We're the one copy of the deed. The other place is the Lamb's Book of Life, where the signature is. Our name is wrote in. Jesus said, writes right over our name, so to speak.
Amen.
So maybe we can get in that, but we made a statement. I made a statement about how Jesus writes. Okay.
Well, guys, listen, as we finish out tonight, we will play another song, but we'll pray. And guys, if you haven't made Jesus Lord of your life, you gotta just cry out to him.
Yes.
Just cry out to him and just invite him in. Let's, Y'all just join us in prayer. Father God, we just thank you, Lord. God, I thank you that Father God, we just, once we receive that gift, God, that gift of grace, that gift of righteousness, Father God, that our names are written in that book, Lord. Father God, I pray right now in Jesus' mighty name, Father God, and anybody listening or hearing this program later, Father God, that doesn't know you, Father God, that they're, if you've been tugging on their heart, Lord, Father God, that they just fall to their knees right now, Father God, and they cry out to you, Lord. Father God, just that they invite you into their heart, God. Father God, just have your way, Lord. Holy Spirit, have your way, God. Father God, and anybody out there, Lord, that's been struggling, Father God, that may have lost focus, Lord, that may have taken their eyes off of you, Father God, and put their eyes on something of the world, Lord, getting choked out by the cares of the world, Father God, that we focus our eyes back on you, Lord. Father God, that we meditate, Father God. I just speak an increase in a hunger and a thirst for righteousness, Father God, a hunger and a thirst for your word, Lord.
Come on.
God, help us to be people of your word, God. God, I pray that we all hunger for time with you above all things, Father God. Time with you, Father God, that intimacy with you, Lord. Father God, because there's nothing else like it. Nothing else can take that place, God. God, I pray for your peace to come upon people right now in Jesus' name, Father God. Lord, anybody out there that has a burden, Father God, anything weighing them down, Father God, we just ask that you take it from them right now, Father God, and you just give them your peace, God. Yes, you say your burden is light, God.
Yes, Lord.
So anybody out there that you're carrying anything that's weighing you down, it ain't yours to carry. Just give it to God.
Yes.
And he'll give you his peace. He'll give you his rest. Lord, I pray for peaceful sleeps tonight, Father God. I pray for dreams and visions, Father God. I ask that you speak to the people tonight, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Father God, I just love you and thank you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Guys, we love you. And we'll be here next week. Join us.
I want to know you, Lord, like I know a friend. I want to know you, Lord. I want to know you, Lord, like I know a friend. I want to know you, Lord. So I'm laying down all my religion. I'm laying down. I want to know you, Lord. I'm laying down all my religion. Box you in, but I'm laying down. I want to know you, Lord. I used to think that I could box you in. Lord, I've been told I'm not
here with me. And I reach out and you find me in the dust. You say no amount of untruth can separate us. I reach out and I reach out and find me in the dust.
Reach out for wisdom, it's crying out in the streets.
And you say no amount of untruths can separate us. I reach out, oh, I reach out and you find me. No amount of untruths can separate us. Oh, I will rejoice in the simple gospel. I will rejoice in you, Lord. I will rejoice. Simple gospel, I will rejoice in you, Lord. I will rejoice in the simple gospel. I will rejoice in you, Lord. I reach out and you.
Yes, Lord.